If you're a hair loss sufferer like I am and you're curious what the difference is between Telogen Effluvium and Androgenetic Alopecia, then stay tuned, this video is for you. Welcome to my channel, my name is Helen. This is gonna be a really basic and hopefully easy to digest video with not too many graphics or like scary looking stuff and charts and all that kind of stuff, but just to give you sort of a background basic information about Telogen Effluvium and Androgenetic Alopecia that you can use as sort of a foundation for learning more and digging in more deeply to it. Full disclosure, I'm not a doctor, I am not a physician, I'm not a healthcare practitioner. What I am is a longtime hair loss sufferer. And here on my channel, I hear from women all the time and I've heard all their different stories, any kind of story about hair loss you can imagine, pretty much, I've heard it, which does not qualify me to diagnose you. So don't leave me any comments asking for a diagnosis because you will not be getting one from me. But if you want my support, you can definitely get that from me. We're all here to support each other. This is a safe space for you. If you're suffering from hair loss, feel free to post whatever you like down below in the comments if it is related to that. So let's just get right into this. What is Telogen Effluvium? I'm not gonna put up any charts or anything like that, but because like they show you sometimes these like pictures of like hair in different stages of loss, and I just find that confusing to look at. Like I don't have the kind of brain that can look at that and really readily understand very quickly what's going on. If you are interested in that, then I suggest you actually read an article, maybe not just hear about it on YouTube, because it just flies by you really quickly. I think sometimes if you read and look at the charts and the different figures and stuff, it will sink more easily into your head. But the basic thing to know about Telogen Effluvium, it is usually caused by a stressful life event of some sort. I made a video here about people who are suffering from Telogen Effluvium as a result of the coronavirus as a sort of side effect. These people have long haul symptoms and side effects that are just ongoing after getting COVID-19, and Telogen Effluvium, aka extreme hair loss, that is sudden, is one of them. So if you're here from that video, you're very welcome. Or if you're concerned about that, I have that video, go ahead and check that out. Anything like, I've heard people go on the keto diet and that's unfortunately triggered something akin to Telogen Effluvium. Of course, we can't say definitively because if they don't have a diagnosis, then they think that that's what it is. But I do believe them, and I've tried keto myself and it made a lot of my hair fall out. So I do tend to believe that that could be a side effect from keto. Another thing that it can be is like sometimes people get surgeries, gastric bypass surgery, different types of major surgeries. That seems to trigger Telogen Effluvium and is a known trigger. Other kinds of illnesses, as we know, postpartum. So like after you have a baby, most of us have experienced a lot of hair loss after that happens. So there's just many different factors that can trigger Telogen Effluvium. And the way that you know that is that a lot of hair loss comes out almost all at once, and it's very, very stressful. Very often in my experience, people say it's noticeable mostly in the shower and mostly when they brush their hair. So those are giveaways that it could be Telogen Effluvium. Of course, as I always say, it's best to get these things checked out. I mean, you can suspect whatever you want, but it's good to get it checked out by a doctor, and the sooner the better in these cases. So that is basically what Telogen Effluvium is. The really good news about Telogen Effluvium is, as devastating as it is to lose tons and tons of hair in the shower in one, very quickly over the span of, you know, a few weeks sometimes, the good news is that with this particular condition, my understanding is that your hair will grow back. It doesn't grow back right away. You're not gonna see your hair grow back in a month, definitely not, but you're in there for a long time and it can take years. That is what I've read. Everything points to taking years. My own experience with losing a lot of hair very quickly is that it did take years to grow back. I'm 3 years post, you know, hair loss. I was completely bald 3 years ago. This entire channel is dedicated pretty much to my own journey, so you can go back and look through my back catalog of videos where you can see me with less hair. And even just the beginning of my like Rogaine experience, that is all documented here for your enjoyment. But yeah, so that is there's a little bit of good news for Telogen Effluvium, so keep that in mind. How does that differ from Androgenetic Alopecia? Androgenetic Alopecia, you may also have heard being called Androgenic Alopecia, almost the same word. And in the old days, and when I mean the old days, I don't mean that long ago, but this is a more recent term, it used to be called female pattern hair loss, and is still sometimes called female pattern hair loss, which is the female version of male pattern hair loss. And what do we know about these conditions? They are genetic, hereditary conditions. There's nothing you've done to make these happen. There's nothing you can do without treatment to stop it from happening. So just rest assured, if you are going through this or you suspect you're going through this, it's nothing you've done. A lot of people blame themselves and they think that there's something they've done. That is not the case. So just go easy on yourself if you suspect this is the case for you. The good news, the good thing to know is that, again, you should go and get it looked at by a doctor, and it can be treatable. There are definitely medications people people take to help with this condition, Rogaine of course being one of them, but there are different pills for men and for women. There are different things that you can do about it. You know, I try only to talk about trustworthy things here, so I don't get too much into stuff that I haven't tried or stuff that's sort of experimental or extremely expensive with low results. So I don't talk too much about that here. I talk about the sort of proven stuff that you would normally hear about from a dermatologist. That might include medications. It definitely includes over-the-counter Rogaine / minoxidil. But the bad thing, you know, about, and I'll give it to you straight, as I always do here, the bad thing about this is that it is a degenerative ongoing condition, like a chronic condition. When you have this, your hair is just generally, you're gonna lose more hair over the years and as time goes by. That's why it's really important, if you're noticing it now, to try and address it. Even if you decide you don't want to do the medicine or you don't want to take on all these other different treatments, that's fine too. But I think that more people are happier living with the sort of disappointment of it not working than the regret of waiting and not trying it until a couple years or down the line. So I really encourage you to take that first step into figuring out what it is that's going on with you. So yeah, those are the two main differences between the two, I would say, most heard of types of hair loss that I definitely come across here on my channel and in my Instagram. Feel free to join me over on Instagram. There's a link in the description box to get in touch with me there. Yeah, hopefully that gives you some oversight into those two conditions, but let's dig just a little bit deeper into these. If you've enjoyed what you've heard so far, if you would do me the great big favor of giving this video a like, that would mean a lot to support the video and the channel. Also consider subscribing. I make all kinds of hair care and hair loss videos and make them all the time. I have a great series that people are really enjoying about mane and tail, like different shampoos, including mane and tail shampoo. That video is doing really well. I did a sort of a 1 week test on that. I did one on Aveda's Invati shampoo line that is supposed to be for hair loss and thickening your hair and stuff like that. I also did Nioxin. Everybody pretty much has heard of Nioxin, and that's a shampoo and conditioner name you're gonna see pop up a lot if you're sort of new to hair loss and you're like new to forums and stuff like that. You'll see people talking, wondering if it's good and stuff like that. Well, I gave them a test, honeys. Go ahead and check those out. And also, if you consider supporting me on Patreon and being one of my patrons there, that would mean so much to me, because right now I don't take any sort of sketchy sponsorships. Like, you're not gonna see right now a sort of homeopathic shampoo video here with me promoting it. I'm just not gonna do that right now. I am unsponsored. I don't take money from, I don't really want to. I don't want to take, you know, $300, whatever it's gonna be. I don't even know what it would be. I have started getting sort of interest, but I've never taken it to the point where I would get an offer, because I wanna keep rejecting those. But I do see offers in my email a lot because my videos are starting to become popular about hair loss and regrowth and stuff like that. And people want me to promote what I consider to be not great products. So I will not do that. But in return, when you do support me on Patreon, that helps me to like purchase shampoos and other things that I need to fund here. Anyhow, I'll stop going on. I'll drop a link below if you're interested in supporting me. Thank you. Thank you so much, okay? Let's get on with it. Okay, so we talked about some of the general differences between telogen effluvium and androgenetic alopecia, and a lot of people go to the dermatologist and they get very flustered and sometimes even angry after. I've heard from people like this too, and that's fine. I understand that sometimes when you go to a dermatologist, they are, and I've experienced this, this comes from experience, they're sometimes a little pressed on time, or they've just seen it all before and they almost have, I don't want to say a callousness, but they have a matter-of-factness that can be very off-putting for people. People feel like, oh, the dermatologist just so quickly looked at me, or they just heard me talk about it and they knew what it was. Well, I'm gonna give it to you again straight here. You know, some people don't get a biopsy and that upsets them. I'm not a doctor, I can't speak for doctors, but generally if you tell them the history and they have eyes, they are used to diagnosing things with their eyes, and they've done this sometimes for many, many years, decades, they know what they're looking at right away. And when you give them your brief history, they know right away, honey. This is, you're not gonna be telling them something that they've never heard before. In those cases, yes, they might give you a biopsy. Sometimes they are not sure. I've known people that have had to get biopsies because just the cause was not entirely clear. But sometimes they will give you a biopsy. So keep in mind that if you are going to a dermatologist appointment, they might offer you a biopsy on your scalp on the spot. So that could happen, but sometimes it doesn't. And the reason is they just know. If you present them with a history of like rapid hair loss that happened because you had XYZ surgery not that long ago, and your hair's coming out in handfuls in the shower, I'm not a doctor, but I will tell you, they will probably hear that and probably think that that's telogen effluvium. They just will. That's enough information visually and from your history for them to make that diagnosis confidently. And likewise, if you say to them, my hair is much thinner through here, through the scalp, sort of through the front here in my hairline, I have diffuse thinning, which means that like there's no actual big round spots, it's just thinning in general on the top of my head. And this has been ongoing since I was in my early 20s or my, you know, mid 30s. That might be enough information for them to diagnose androgenetic, or as it's also pronounced, androgenic alopecia. it might just be. I mean, these are the experts and that's how they diagnose things from hearing your story. Those are two very distinct hair loss patterns. So sometimes they can diagnose it just from that. So if you get that, that doesn't mean that they didn't care, or they didn't hear you carefully, or they didn't look. Like sometimes if they just look at you and they see you, like what I'm trying to say is androgenic alopecia has a pretty distinct thinning look, and it, they sometimes describe it as looking as kind of like a Christmas tree type pattern for women. And if your derm sees that, they're probably gonna be able to rule the other stuff out pretty quickly, especially if you tell them you've been experiencing hair loss, or maybe that you have a history of it in your family. I don't know. I'm not sitting in on all these dermatologist appointments. I'm just trying to tell you that's what I understand about these conditions, and that's what I've been hearing from people that get in touch with me. If you're upset because you feel like it was just very cursory, I'm just trying to give you some background on perhaps what your dermatologist's way of coming to that diagnosis has been. And then if you want a biopsy, sometimes you will get one. So, you know, sometimes even getting a biopsy will depend on whether what you want. If you really don't want one, they might just give you some medications and tell you to try that. But if you really do want one, they may give you one. I mean, every derm will be different in how they approach these things, and I cannot obviously speak for them, being not even a doctor myself. There are other types of hair loss that I haven't even got into here. There's, you know, alopecia areata, which is sort of circles of hair loss. There is like just even postmenopausal hair thinning. A lot of women experience thinning hair. I know that that's certainly the case for me. My hair's a lot thinner than it used to be, and now that I'm in early menopause, it's just never gonna be as thick as it used to be, and I accept that. There are just many, there's like alopecia universalis, where you lose all of your hair, your eyebrows, all the hair on your body. That happens as well. There are a lot of different types of hair loss that are out there. I've just tried to cover the two basic ones. Those are just foundations so that when you hear these terms, you kind of have a general idea of what's going on. Do not try and necessarily diagnose yourself. I would definitely say, you know, pick up that phone or send that email out to your doctor, to your GP, and just get the ball rolling. Almost everybody that does end up at the doctor says, I wish that I had addressed this years ago. You can go and watch other hair loss YouTubers here, and generally they will say that they wish they started moving on this earlier and they waited too long, because the earlier you start on it, very often, the faster you can start taking treatments that may be effective. And even if they're not effective, at least you tried it, you can rule it out, you can move on, whatever that journey might look like for you. And if you feel like you'll never recover from hair loss, let me tell you this one thing and leave you with this. You know, very truthfully, not everybody recovers from hair loss. There are some conditions that you cannot recover from. Medication is not, Rogaine, whatever it may be, is not effective for everybody. But you as a person will recover no matter what. Like, go online, go on Instagram and see, you know, search up alternative hair, look at that hashtag, and you'll see women who will talk very frankly about all the stuff that they did for their hair loss and how it didn't work and how they've moved on. And very often you'll see that they are happier than ever because alternative hair looks amazing. Alternative hair looks better than this hair will ever look, you know, and probably look better than any of the hair I ever had when my hair looked nice way back when. A beautiful wig, topper will always look better than natural hair. Almost always will look better than natural hair. So keep that in mind. This is a journey, and you know, you will recover. Maybe your hair will not, but you as a person, you will recover no matter what, I promise you. Okay, so I hope all of that was helpful. Thank you so much for spending your valuable time for me. Again, that was just a really brief intro, so hopefully that helped you out. I wanna hear from you. Leave me a comment down below about your own journey, but do not ask me to diagnose you because I will not be doing that. But I always love to hear your opinions on this, your thoughts, your comments. Thank you so much for watching, and we will see you soon.